weeks, this Sunday and next Sunday, we are looking at the very heart of our faith. We are looking this Sunday and next at two major events of Jesus that form the foundation of our faith as believers in this new covenant. And those two essential events, those two foundational events, are Jesus dying and Jesus rising. And in keeping with this Sunday before Resurrection Sunday, today I want you to think with me, and there's so many things we could speak about that were related to his dying. But I realize we have limited time, and so I'm actually gonna do a part two to this message on Tuesday night, because I had so many things, I knew I couldn't get them all in today. So part one is today, and then we'll do part two on Tuesday night. So we'll consider even more thoroughly with both of those our awesome Lord and Savior and the significance of his dying for us. For today's consideration, I want you to turn, if you will, to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27. And I'd like you to stand for these four verses. We'll read Matthew 27, verses 27 through 31. Matthew chapter 27, beginning at verse 27 through verse 31. If you have a New King James, you know what, I promised you something, I didn't keep my promise. I'm mindful of it now. Where's my secretary, Bert? Where's Bert? Bert's in here, she's teaching? Okay, help me every week to have the scripture to go up on that screen. And it got past me this week. I wanna start having it on the screen. Matthew, if you have a New King James, please follow along with us or read with us. We have another version, follow along. Matthew 27, 27 through 31. Will you read with me? Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." Then they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off him, put his own clothes on him, and led him away to be crucified. Lord, thank you for a fresh unveiling and releasing of understanding, of insight, of discernment and perception. Holy Spirit, thank you for unveiling Jesus and the significance of this time to us, that our hearts may even deepen in appreciation and gratitude for what has happened. We thank you for doing that now in Jesus' name. And all the people said,
amen,
amen and amen. I love each and every one of you. I really do love you. But I wouldn't give my son for you. I wouldn't give either one of my sons, because I love them. I love you. I wouldn't let any of my sons pay for anything any of us did wrong. And yet God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes on him should not perish but have everlasting life. In the giving of his son, God would have to allow his son, who never sinned, to be numbered among the transgressors who did. God had to allow his sinless son to die the way convicted criminals died. And I cannot fathom, I cannot fully grasp the love of God, because none of Jesus coming to die for us was something Jesus and the Father didn't know would have to be done before they created us.
Amen.
And they could have just stopped this whole ball of wax before it ever became a ball of wax. And they could have said, well, since they're going to be doing that, that they just won't come to exist. Knowing man would fall, God still made him. Not only did he make him, but he established the plan of salvation before there was creation. There was a creation first and then salvation. There was salvation first and then creation. The word of God says Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God who was foreordained before, come on, before the foundation of the world. Man was created after the foundation of the world. But God foreordained Jesus to be the Lamb of God to redeem man before the foundation of the world. And so here he is making this man and dear woman, and knowing they're going to mess it up. They're going to really mess it up. But we have a plan to fix it up before they can ever mess it up. Jesus comes forever changing humanity and forever changing the Godhead. His coming brought everlasting change. Because he has come, God is now also a member of the human race. Yes. Yes. He's not just the creator of the human race. He's a member of it. And because he's come, he's not only brought divinity into humanity. He brought humanity into divinity. Since he's come, whenever God says, let us, one of the us is also a man. So a man sits as God the Son at the right hand of God the Father. Fully God, fully man. He comes. He allows himself in the verses we read to be, you don't catch the full impact of it in Matthew's account or even all the Gospels. Isaiah caught a dimension of it when Isaiah said he was marred beyond recognition.
Yeah. Yeah.
We read just a passing verse of them striking him. What we don't understand is that they beat him until you couldn't even recognize him as a man. And often when they would crucify someone who was a common criminal, the execution wouldn't just start on Calvary, it would start when the soldiers took them into the praetorium and treated that person like a criminal. And for whatever reason, well, I think I know, because he was paying for the sins of the world. He bore abuse greater than any other person had ever borne it. So when he goes, because normally the person to be crucified would carry his own cross, unless by the beating and whipping that he had experienced, he was too exhausted to carry it. And Jesus suffered such abuse with those guards that he actually needed help. Someone had to carry his cross. And I want you to look at that, because this is the first thing I want you to understand. Look at verse 32. Now, as they came out of the praetorium where he had been beaten beyond recognition, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. Cyrene is a province in Libya, North Africa. And at this time, Cyrene, who was a North African, was coming out of Jerusalem. And the soldiers, when they were crucifying someone, if that person couldn't carry their cross, they could legally compel anybody around them into the service of carrying that cross. And this is very significant.
Yes, it is.
Because at this time, those of Simon's culture were looked down upon. Simon, as a North African, has been, in fact, there was, history says, there was even a synagogue of the Cyrenians in Jerusalem at that time, whether he was coming from there or just coming from the city. They forced him. They didn't ask him. They forced him to carry Jesus' cross. And there's no record that he even recognized whose cross he was carrying. Can you imagine being made to carry somebody's cross and later on finding out it was the Lord? The attempt to look down on Simon really forever exalted him. Because he's in the Gospels and in eternity as the one who carried the cross of Jesus. Now, can you imagine having those credentials? I mean, listen, if I did nothing else in life except have that distinction, I got to carry the cross that brought salvation to the world. This is the first thing I wanted you to pay attention to in this time surrounding him going to die. God made sure that the despised were lifted up while he was on the way to the cross. Secondly, please note this. As he was put on the cross, in verse 45 of chapter 27, it says, now from the sixth hour or from noon until the ninth hour or three in the afternoon, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour or three in the afternoon, because the crucifixion actually started at 9:30 in the morning. And here we are at three in the afternoon. At three in the afternoon, or about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? At the time he was made to be sin for us, the sin bearer, the one who was made to be sin. Jesus would temporarily experience as the God-man what it was like to be separated from the Father. Now, see, when you and I are born, we're separated from God, but we are people separated from God. Here is God separated from God. Now, we don't know fellowship with God like God knows fellowship with God. We don't know closeness with God like God knows closeness with God. We weren't around from eternity past, but in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh. So Jesus has eternity past and all the memories of that intimacy. I submit to you that the greatest suffering of Calvary was not the nails, was not the beating, was not the holes in his feet. It was him experiencing separation from the Father as the bearer of our sins. How is it that one man could pay for the sins of all people?
That blows my mind.
It blows mine too, man. Think about this. One man wiped out the sins of the world. How is that possible? Listen to me. Sin, as terrible as it is, can never be greater than its source. Do you hear what I'm saying? Sin, as great as it is, never came from an infinite being. Every person who sinned was created. Because you see, sin didn't start with Adam. Sin started in heaven with Satan and those angels who got kicked out. So he was the first sinner coming to the garden. But sin can never be infinite. It can be significant. It can be great. The volume of it can be massive. But it can never be infinite because its source is never infinite. I'm telling you. But please understand that it wasn't just a man bearing our sins. It wasn't just a man bringing his righteousness. It was God bringing his righteousness to Calvary. And when his righteousness met our sins, the infinite wiped out the finite. That which has no boundaries destroyed that which does. That which has no limit took care of that which does. He brought infinite righteousness to Calvary. Oh, God, 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 God. And the righteousness was so great that it's beyond as those in him, as those who believe in him. His righteousness was so great that it became something more. It was something more than just a possession. His righteousness was so great, it has become our identity. God made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, so that now in him, we who have believed in him have become, not have become the righteousness of God. The righteousness Jesus brought to Calvary doesn't just affect what we have. It affects who we are. So with all of my imperfections, and while I'm still being perfected in him, I am the righteousness of God. While God is still pruning me, while God is still developing me, while God is still getting me ready, in him, I am the righteousness of God. He brought such infinite righteousness to Calvary that it was too great just to affect the possession of those who tapped it. It changed their identity. So we don't start in Christ with what we have. We start in Christ with who we are. God. So one man's righteousness can pay for the sins of the world, when that one man is God and his righteousness is infinite. Listen, let me put it to you another way. The world doesn't even have the capacity to sin like he has the capacity to be righteous. The ability to sin is not as great as the level of righteousness he brought to Calvary. The greater force wiped out the lesser. My. Yeah. And to do that, he was separated from the Father. But listen, I submit to you, though he was separated from the Father, he was never separated from himself. He was still God the Son, being the Lamb of God. He was still God the Son being made to be sin. He was still God the Son bringing all of his righteousness to put to the account of those who had sinned. I marvel at you, Jesus. When he died, something also happened. Not only did Simon carry his cross, and not only did he experience separation from the Father, but please note how he died. Now, this is not even in my notes, but it's in my spirit. It's flowing. Please understand how he died. He wasn't killed.
That's right.
He said, nobody takes my life from me. No. You give me a chance to lay it down, but I lay it down and I have the power to pick it back up again. You got to understand who you're dealing with here. So listen, he wasn't killed. When that terminology is used, it's only describing the intent of those who crucified him. It's not describing the impact of how he died. No man could ever kill God. Hello! The only way Jesus could die on Calvary was to dismiss his own spirit. The sins of the world could not take him out. And if you study it, Pilate was amazed because ordinarily when crucifixion would happen, it would be a pretty slow process, and they would eventually break the legs of the person being crucified to speed up the death. When they came, they saw the other two were still suffering and hadn't died. They broke their legs. But when they came to Jesus, he had already gone. But he left on his terms. Father, into your hands I release my spirit. I'm coming to deal with this matter. I'm coming to pay a price, and I'm leaving on my terms. So please, when you think about Calvary, think about it as him laying down his life, not as somebody taking it. Because they could crucify him, but they could not kill him. Crucifixion did not kill him. He released his spirit, because the only way God could leave here, he'd have to send himself out. See, people die because they can't help it.
That's right.
The only way Jesus could die is he had the will to do it. And will the time that he would release his spirit. He stayed in control of the process. God. When he died, this is also additional, so give me a minute. This is good to me. It's not coincidental that the very last words he uttered before dying were words of prayer. Jesus' last words on earth were prayers to the Father. And if you look at this, I'm sure if you're around church for any length of time, you know about the seven last words of Jesus. The first of the seven last words, Father, forgive them. Prayer. The last of the seven words, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Prayer. Jesus sandwiched the last seven words, or the seven last words, with words of prayer on both ends.
That's right.
And it's not coincidental that prayer would be so significant on Calvary when prayer was so significant before Calvary. Nobody has prayed on this earth like Jesus did. This earth has never seen a prayer warrior like Jesus. Which is why he qualifies to be the eternal intercessor. Yeah. Well, when he prayed that last prayer and committed himself and released himself, his spirit, to the Father and breathed his last with that utterance, something happened to the temple. In the temple, there was the most holy place where the high priest would go once a year to offer the sacrifice, and it was separated from the holy place where people could come, the priest could go, and those sacrifices were being offered up to God from the time of Moses. In fact, sacrifices to God, pointing to Jesus' sacrifice, you can even read with Abraham. Abraham understood something about how to approach God with sacrifice. And sacrifices may have been going on up until the moment he released his spirit to the Father. But please note, and we're not taking the time to read it, but it's right there. I'll give you the scripture. So that, all right, Holy Spirit, I thank you. I will read it. Jesus cried out in verse 50 again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. The way to approach God that had been in place for thousands of years ended with the last breath of Jesus. He shifted from the time he released that last breath. The veil of the temple was torn in two and destroyed. Now, it's interesting that in this earthquake, the word of God doesn't say the homes were destroyed. No, this quake was targeting one area. It was targeting the temple, and God was shutting down the old way because a new and better way had been opened up. From the time he shed his blood on Calvary, a whole new way was opened. And that partition that divided the races was torn down in the temple, so that now through him from Calvary, there is universal access to God by one person. Anybody, anywhere in the world now can come to God by one person. And I pity, I know we live in a country, and I thank God that we live in a country that permits people to worship as they so choose. My heart just goes out to people who don't know, who don't understand. People who think that their own good works can get them something with God. Or people who think some other deity is the way. Or people who think if you just live morally. People who don't understand that God has made possible and ordered the eternal sacrifice of his son because that's the only way. That veil was torn. No priest could offer any animal sacrifices in that temple after he breathed his last on Calvary, because the Lamb of God had offered himself to the Father. Good God Almighty. So why receive a lamb when you can have the Lamb? And I love this. So great was that blood that God didn't wait. The Father didn't wait until that blood actually reached the heavenly tabernacle to shut the temple down. He shut the temple down when the blood was shed. As soon as that blood was shed, he shut it down. No, I don't need a lamb anymore. I got the lamb. I don't need animal blood now. There is the blood of God. And so, this new way, this better way, this wonderful way. And see, please understand the power of blood. Amen. Blood, amen. The life of the flesh was in the blood. It's in the blood. The Lord said, be careful when you're eating in the old covenant, not to eat the blood of the animal, because the life of the flesh is in the blood. And I have given you blood for atonement. And when Cain slew Abel, and God said, what is this you have done? What you don't understand is that your brother's blood is calling out to me from the ground. Please understand this today. I thank God for our wonderful systems of policing and investigation. But every murderer that got away from the system.
Talk about it, sir.
Has had somebody's blood calling out to God. So people think they get by because they get through a system. There's another system that nobody gets by. Now listen. If Abel's blood that was wrongfully shed could call out to God from the ground. How much more does the very blood of God that's speaking from the very heavenly tabernacle, that's not calling out for justice, it's satisfied justice. It's calling out for our mercy. So then, because that blood has been shed and that blood is speaking over my life, the word of God says I can boldly come to the throne of grace and obtain mercy. He said, no matter what else you're coming for, you'll always be able to obtain mercy. Why? The blood is speaking that over your life. And if a man's blood could call for justice from the ground, the blood of God can sure call for mercy from the throne. It's the blood. It's the blood. It's the blood. Thank God for the blood. Amen. The only blood in the history of time that carried Zoe life. When God made man, Zoe life wasn't in the blood, it was in the breath of God going into him. His body came from the ground. Jesus' body did not come from the ground. The Spirit of God put his body in the womb as a seed of the Virgin Mary. His very body came from the Holy Spirit, so that the blood that flowed in him carried the life of the source that deposited his body in the womb of the Virgin. So his very blood carried Zoe life. So Peter said we weren't redeemed with corruptible things or things subject to decay. The blood is not subject to decay. If Jesus had not taken it to heaven, it would still be here on earth. Because time could not diminish it. Nothing in this earth's atmosphere could cause it to decay. It carried the very life of God. So you can understand that when it covers me and covers you, it covers us with the very life of God. Oh, the blood. There's a song, oh, the blood. Oh, the blood has signed my name. Ah, God. My. This has been good. Let me make one more point from here. Because the Lord has cleared up my understanding in an area that needed to be cleared up. When he died. This also happened. When he died. This didn't happen when he rose. This happened when he died. People were raised when he died. If you look at this in verse 51 and 52, then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two. After he cried out and yielded up his spirit, the temple was torn in two. And verse 52, and the graves were open. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves, after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So great was the force of his life impacting death that people started coming out of death when he died. It's almost like he took up so much room. Somebody had to go. Who are these people? These are not just, they are saints. But please keep in mind, these are old covenant saints. Old covenant saints. Because the way had not been opened and the blood of Jesus had not been taken back to heaven. When people died before Christ, they did not go to heaven.
That's right.
The saints went to a place called Abraham's bosom, or Sheol. And apparently it's located somewhere in the heart of the earth. Because Jesus said, as Jonah was in the heart of the whale, the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth. You remember in Luke 16, when he talked about Lazarus and the rich man. And they both died. Lazarus was righteous. The rich man didn't know God. So when the rich man died, he went to a place of torment. Yes. But from that place of torment, he could still see Lazarus. And so apparently that place of torment and that place of Abraham's bosom was in the heart of the earth. When Jesus died, that's where he went. He went there. Because even though Abraham's bosom was a place of bliss, it wasn't heaven. They were held as captives in the place of bliss until he went there. Look at this with me. I want you to understand it. It's God had to help me understand it, and I want you to understand it. Ephesians 4. I'm almost done. Thank you. I wish more than two people had said that. So I'm just having fun. Listen, look at Ephesians 4, verse 8. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now, this he ascended, what does it mean? But that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth. He went to Sheol. He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. Now, I had been thinking for much of my Christian life that when it talks about him leading captivity captive, it was exclusively referencing the spirits of darkness which he conquered. I don't think so. Because those spirits aren't led to heaven. He's ascending to the throne. When he ascended, he led those who had been captives in Sheol from Sheol to heaven. You hear what I'm saying? So that from the time he ascended, no saint dies and goes to Abraham's bosom.
Because his blood has gone up to the throne and the way has been made now to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. The moment I leave here, I am visibly present with him. There's no waiting place. His blood has eliminated the waiting place. Now when I leave, I'm right there where I can see him. I'm not leaving here to go to Abraham's bosom. He emptied Abraham's bosom and took all of those saints up to the throne of God. Nobody's captive anymore anywhere who's a saint of the Most High God. But you see, the Old Testament saints were on the front side of the blood being shed. The way had to be opened up. But can you imagine them being in the place of bliss? He shed his blood and pays them a visit. Say, I got something better for you. I'm getting ready to leave here, but I'm taking you out of here with me. Glory to God. Glory to God. And while he's leading that great throng of believers to the throne, he's giving out the fivefold gifts to the church. He's releasing the apostles. Because listen, all of those gifts were in him.
Amen.
He was every one of those. He was the apostle, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, and the teacher. It was all in him. So he releases his headship gifts to the fivefold place of the church. So that the church can be equipped out of his headship gifts to be like him. Oh, come on, bless him, somebody. Woo! Who is like the Lord? Nobody's like our God. Nobody like our God. So please know now, he didn't lead defeated spiritual powers to the throne. No, they got put out. They never go back. They don't ascend with him. When the scripture says he led captivity captive, that meant captivity got to follow where he was leading. And he ascended to the throne. And the saints that had been captive, waiting for that blood to be shed, could now leave Abraham's bosom for something much better. The one who had shed the blood came on down there and said, come on, let's go. The way is made now. Let's go. So he's forever now changed the way believers leave here. Amen. The Apostle Paul said to be absent is to be present. He didn't say to be absent and then wait a while, and then you'll get there. No, he says, the moment you're absent from here, you're present with him there. No waiting period. Oh, come on, bless him, somebody. Come on. Let's give him a praise in here. So great was the power of his shed blood that no believer ever leaves his presence.
He's with us here.
Yes.
He's in us here.
Yes, sir.
We see him there.
Hallelujah.
And as soon as we leave here, because he has collapsed the space, there's no waiting time. As soon as we leave here, every saint that's not present with him is still here. You can't be. If you're here, you're still here. But I love what the Apostle Paul said. He said, though it's necessary for me to be here, I can serve God here, I'm not at home here. I'm away from the Lord, visibly here. But as soon as I'm absent from the body, I'm looking right at him. Father, I thank you for this time to just look at some of the aspects of our Lord and Savior, our hero of all heroes, our King of all kings, the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus will never get over what you've done. We'll never be able to thank you enough. Thank you that you've not only made it possible for us, when we finish our assignment here, to go to a better place, there's no waiting period. You've collapsed that by what you did on Calvary and afterwards. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I need you to stand now. Jesus, I love you. I love you, Jesus. I love you. All the OT saints didn't rise, but a significant number of them rose from the dead and went apparently back up bodily to heaven. God has so many things in the scripture you can't fully wrap your arms around. You just have to read it and praise the Lord and keep on going. I marvel at him. I marvel at him. Today, in this moment, of time, we've listened for the last few moments to just some of the descriptions of how the Lord Jesus Christ made possible for us to have a better life on this side and the side to come. He didn't just say, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly when you leave here. No, he says, that starts when you make me Lord here. A better life starts the moment I make him Lord. And it just continues to get better and better until I see him face to face. But it starts the moment I make him Lord. A better life starts. And is there anybody here today who would say, Pastor, I want that better life. I want the better life. I want what Jesus came and died and rose again to give me. I want that, Pastor. I want, you can have it. You can have it. Jesus made it possible for each of us to receive it. Anyone here? I'm looking. God bless you. This is why it's also so important to touch as many people as we can.
Amen.
Thank God for Minister Godfrey Solomon last Sunday, and that awesome word that the Lord gave him, and the importance of touching and sharing this. This is too big just to keep a secret. It's too big to just personally enjoy. I got to share it. And so I'm in my neighborhood, y'all. I'm mapping out my neighborhood, and I'm building relationships. Because you know what? I got to share this. It's too great to be kept. Yeah. Yeah. When Jesus rose from the dead, the thing he told Mary Magdalene, go tell somebody. Go tell somebody. Do you know he died for us? Do you know he's forever changed how people can die? Do you know he's got a life that's much better for you here than you could ever have for yourself? Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Come on, let's give him one more praise offering for what he's done. Thank you. Thank you so much. Lord Jesus, our offerings, our tithes can never be to you what you have given to us. They can only be tokens of our gratitude and our commitment to you. They can only be declarations of our covenant with you. But in this covenant, you have always given more to us than we could ever give back to you. So today, on the heels of this word about the great offering of yourself, we bring our tithes and offerings to celebrate your lordship and to declare that we have divine connection to you. Thank you for your blessings on us. As we do that now, come on up, ushers.